Welcome to West Cemetery as we commemorate the final resting place of Peter Summers, the brains of the original 6-in-a-row Celtic team from 1905 to 1910. We welcome today's speakers, David Potter, Celtic historian and author of over a dozen Celtic books. When David talks of Celtic and that lovely Fife twang, people listen. Not like my Clyde Bank accent, maybe they can make me out. Next up, we then have Abernathy's historian, Peter McLeish, who's been a great help with us in researching Peter Summers. The former Celt, of course, played for the Aggies at the start of his career and ended his career there as well, before he joined the board at Hamon Aggies. So we're delighted to welcome Peter today to celebrate with us the life of Peter Summers. We always say the most important people at any ceremony are the family. And although the family can't be here today as they're based in California, Peter Summers' great niece, Susan Summers, has sent us some words which she wants read out today. And what she says is this: in 1928, my father, Peter Summers, then 15, left Scotland with his family and arrived in the United States. Scotland was always in his heart and a big part of our identity. My father recounted many tales of his hometown of Hamilton in Scotland. He always held in high regard his uncle and namesake, the great Celtic player, Peter Summers. The Celtic's powder monkey's picture hung in the pubs of Hamilton. My father remembered a pint of ale being toasted in his memory. The Summers family is humbled to learn that Peter Summers is still memorialised today and are honoured to be part of this amazing Celtic football history. And that's from Susan Summers, Peter Summers' great niece. Isn't that lovely? Now, after the speeches, we then get the chance to lay some flowers in the grave before I close the ceremony with some words of thanks. Ladies and gentlemen, it's often difficult to imagine the worth of a Celtic player who played over a century ago, but we've got a lot of clues. Maybe it makes it easier to compare Peter Summers' traits to the sum of the Celtic players from a more modern era. For example, it was said that Peter Summers had no love for the rough and tumble football, so he was no Scott Brown. He was described as a subtle strategist, the brains of the 6-in-a-row team. He was maybe a bit like Paul McStay. He was described as nimble of foot and nimble of tongue, so possibly a cheeky chappy that Lee Griffiths are very old. Although you couldn't imagine Peter Summers eating a turnips tea cake sitting behind Wally Whaley. You like that one? But we can judge the man better in some hard facts. As Wally Whaley himself said, of all the men who have played the inside forward game for us, the McMenemy, Quinn and Summers combination was the best. When you add Alec Bennett and David Hamilton to each wing, we had the best five-man attack Celtic have ever seen. Summers played in the Celtic team who come back from 2 goals down to beat Rangers 3-2 in the 1904 Scottish Cup final, with Jimmy Quinn scoring a hat-trick. As we've said, he was the brains of the 6-in-a-row team who dominated Scottish football from 1905 to 1910. He won 3 Scottish Cups in 1904, 1907 and 1908. He was central to the 1908 Celtic team who won all 4 trophies that we entered that season. He played in the only Celtic team that could compare to the Lisbon Lions. When he left Celtic in 1910 to return to Hamilton Aggies, it was 4 years before the league flag returned to Celtic Park. Jimmy Quinn, who scored over 20 goals a season for 6 years in a row whilst playing alongside Summers, never scored 20 goals in a season for Celtic again after Summers left. It was 60 years before the 6-in-a-row record would be broken. But Peter Summers had the final say at the end of his career when his Hamilton Aggies side reached the Scottish Cup final for the first time. And who did they meet in the 1911 Cup final? Of course, none other than Celtic. Although he didn't play in a final, His influence on the Aki's was clear as they lost narrowly 2-0 to the Celts after a replay. And Peter Sommer called it quits on his glorious career after the match. He went on to serve on the Aki's board. The tragedy struck in 1914 when he passed away, aged only 36. But as we celebrate Peter Sommer's life over a century later, we ensure that he'll never be forgotten and his name will go on forever. Please welcome Celtic historian David Potter to say a few words.
What can the matter be? Rangers got beat from Celtic on Saturday. 2 goals from Quinn and 1 from McMenemy. Oh, what fun it was there. That was one of the ditties that was sung by the supporters at that time. Unfortunately, it doesn't tie in with the facts. I can find no game where Jimmy Quinn scored twice and McMenemy scored once against Rangers. They did against Hibs on one occasion, but that's no bother to do that. Let's think about the Celtic story, the first Celtic history book other than Melies himself, which was written by James Handley. And he quotes from The Blessed Damozel, which was a poem, and he talks about five handmaidens whose names are five sweet symphonies: Cecilia, Gertrude, Madeline, Margaret, and Rosalind. Something akin to the stirring of this divine afflatus comes to the Celtic fan as they roll off the tongue, trippingly and lovingly, a litany that made music for him in five sweet symphonies: Bennett, McMenemy, Quinn, Summers, and Hamilton. Now, for a very short time, Hamilton was replaced by Bobby Templeton in 1907, but most of the time it was David Hamilton. And it's my job today, very briefly, to talk maybe about the other four members of the forward line. Enough has been said and written about Peter Summers. Alec Bennett, the artful dodger, came from Rutherglen. Big question about Alec: why on earth did you go to Rangers in 1908? We don't know. It's often said that he couldn't cope with the Roman Catholic ethos of the club at the time. I don't personally buy that, because people like Sonny Jim Young coped with it perfectly well. So did Jim Hay and Davy McLean, who came from the same place as I do in Forfa. They were all Church of Scotland people, Protestants. They coped very well with Celtic. So I don't really buy that. And I think it may possibly come down quite simply to the fact that Rangers in 1908 offered him more money. I think it was possibly just as simple as that. That was the reason why Alec Bennett left to go to Rangers. But it was very sad, and he got a wee bit of his comeuppance later on in his life, because after the Great War, he became the manager of Third Lanark. And in Third Lanark, in the early 20s, he had a guy called Tommy McAnally to cope with, and that would not have been easy, but anyway. Moving on to Jimmy McMenemy, Napoleon. What can be said about Napoleon that hasn't been said before? Arguably Celtic's best ever player, although we'd have to go some to beat Patsy Gallagher and Jimmy Johnson, but I would certainly put Napoleon up there very, very high in that list. Willie Mealy said the way he played football, it was like a chessboard. He also deserves great credit, I think, for what he did in the 1930s, when he was in fact more or less the manager of the club, the team that won the Empire Exhibition Trophy, because Mealy was ill, awkward, curmudgeonly, wouldn't turn up some days, and effectively it was Jimmy McMenemy, who was the trainer, who actually ran the team and did quite a lot of the tactics. So I give Jimmy McMenemy a great deal of credit for that. And the great thing that these two teams had in common was the fact that they could interchange. The reason why Templeton was dropped in favour of Hamilton was he wasn't quite as good a team man. The team could interchange, move all over the place, and both these teams, both these forward lines, could do that. You know, Bennett, McMenemy, Quinn, Summers and Hamilton, Delaney, McDonald, Crumb, Divers and Murphy. Incidentally, in my family, I have a wee piece of the apostolic succession, almost, if I may put it like this. You know, when a grandchild is born, you say, this little piggy went to market, this little piggy, I say, Bennett, McMenemy, Quinn, Summers and Hamilton. Delaney, McDonald, Crum, Divers and Murphy. R. Thompson, E. Thompson, McGrory, Scarf and Napier. Johnston, Wallace, Chalmers, Lennox and all. That is my apostolic succession. Jimmy Quinn, what can we say about Jimmy Quinn? I can quote the London Evening Dispatch from 1910. Is there a better centre forward in the kingdom than Jimmy Quinn? If so, who is he? It just leaves it like that. That is Jimmy Quinn, the man from Croy. Some say that the Rangers are good at football, that Smith, Speedy and Gordon are braw. But Jimmy Quinn, he diddled them all at the Glasgow Exhibition. Oh, that was 1902 when they won the first, well, it's called the Empire Exhibition Cup, something's called the All British Cup, something's called the Coronation Cup, but they beat Rangers in 1902, the first Coronation Cup, as they said, yes. Then, leaving aside Peter Summers, I agree he was as good as any, but I'll let other people talk about Peter and so on. But we come to the last one, who was Davy Hamilton, the dancer, often underestimated, but only underestimated because he was up beside so many great players. In the same way that I felt that my father always said that Frank Murphy, the outside left in the late 30s, was a great, great player, but always suffered a little bit in comparison with Jimmy Delaney. But he always felt that he was just as good. Davy Hamilton, I think, well worth his position in that great forward line. And I will conclude by giving tribute to five women who were Annie Drennan, Rose McCluskey, Annie Lang, Jeannie Mitchell, and Mary Ann Gilroy, who were the five wives of that great forward line. So in fact, their names were Annie Bennett, Rose McMenemy, Annie Quinn, Jeannie Summers, and Mary Ann Hamilton. Thank you for listening.
Only David Potter, thanks for what you. Please welcome Hamilton Ackies, historian Peter McLeish. Hope you're going to give us a song, Peter.
music and song. I like the air about it, and I hate the tune you get there. Messenger and Henry, his son played there.
I was a kid, so.
I am not in my time. Much of what I'm going to say you've already got. Booklet there, but I'll say it anyway just in case you missed it the first time round. He was born in Straven, Peter. His father was a baker and he was born on the 3rd of June. As far as I can find out, his first team were Mossley and Celtic. They were the junior team, of course. And in 1895, they won the Lanarkshire Junior League. Now it's possible that Peter might have played in that team because he was in 17-18. Because it was shortly after that he moved to Cadge Row, which isn't really that far away from here. And while he played with them, he was chosen in the team to represent the Lanarkshire Junior League against the Midlothian League in March 1897. And it was that year that he came to Hamilton, and the city played to Ackies in their very first Scottish League match. Brenton had lost a place for various reasons. Played five matches during that particular season, and Ackies were put in place. Unfortunately, with the people, the results that Brenton had, and Brenton had lost a whole lot in the The good news is, we finished second bottom of the league that year. Murrow would have been.
That's
quite a good
one.
That was nice.
Proud of that. Anyway, so the first Scottish League game was against Kilmarnock. And two players signed for that particular game were Captain Sally Barton from Mulbankery, which is this way, and the other was a young man, Peter Summers. And he played inside left, strange enough. That's a surprise, I'm sure. Well, a lot of you'll know, they're too young to go inside left now, but number 10. And no numbers in these days either. But his first game was against Kilmarnock. You seem to be getting a lot of the rain on the unfortunately, actually lost 3-2. From Livingston, who scored one of those, Dewey Eglin, and the other was a known goal. So we play Kilmarnock a week today, so I hope the results are not the same, but leaving the points. 2 weeks later, they didn't play in the next game. Fortnight later, played, this was at Douglas Park again. It was against Lindtown. The Ackies beat them 1-0. And that was the first game they won in the league. 2 days later, they went to Celtic. And the following week, 3 weeks after he played his first game for Ackies, he played his first game for Celtic against Padlanock. And he scored one of the goals in a 4-0 win. I think he scored 3 goals in his first 3 matches. For whatever reason, he was loaned out to play. The information I've got is purely Ackies stuff. They haven't had any deal with the fight. Other than he was loaned there and went to Blackburn as well. And they paid £200 for the benefit of his services. He was there, I think, a couple of years before they headed back to Parkhead. A wee bit of misnomer, can I correct you on something that you said earlier?
Yeah.
His first match when he came back to Hampshire was actually in 1909. Mm-hmm. It was December the 9th. Unfortunately, the match was abandoned due to ground conditions. I think it was snowing. You know, that happens around about here sometimes. And that is, I think they were, let me see, I think they were 1 up at the time. Or they were 2-1 up at the time. And there were 6,000 folk there. I wish we could get that here. I know that's nothing that you get. There'll be nothing in the end of this, but we don't get that. As was mentioned earlier, it was on the staff of the club when they got to the final against that other team that you mentioned earlier. Quite surprising because they were never at that particular time. They had a poor record in the mid-table in the league. They were never, you know, that far up in the league that we expected to get to the cup final, but they did it on that occasion. And I'm no doubt, although as I was saying, he didn't play in the cup final, I'm no doubt his influence while he was a player here had a lot to do with that. Although one competition which he did pick up a winner's medal while he was at Hamilton, the Lanarkshire Cup. The Lanarkshire Cup at that time was quite prestigious, obviously, here, because it wasn't just Motherwell, Liverpool, Elgin Rovers and stuff. It was about Royal Albert and the junior club, they were senior. It was Dykehead, it was Shorts, Willerglen. The whole of the senior club, Hamburg Lang Rangers, clubs like that were all gone. So the Lanarkshire Cup had a bit of status to it. So he actually maintained his medal by winning one in the Lanarkshire Cup against Bushwell Thistle, who again are no longer. But that game had been played and a draw. The replay was also a draw. So it was decided rather than have another game, no penalties, penalty kicks in these days, and probably hadn't been play another game either. So the officials, the Lanarkshire Association officials decided that both clubs could hold the trophy jointly. So he got a medal while he was at Ackies, and that was the only one he got in the that same month, he played for Ackies against Celtic on the 22nd of August 1910 in a benefit match near of St Mary's School, which is over there. And the match ended 1-8. His final league appearance for Ackies was against Hearts on the 18th of March 1911. Castle in a league fixture which the home team won 2-0. I mentioned Royal Albert earlier. On the 12th of April, the same month as the cup final, they didn't play in any of the rounds of the cup final at all, unfortunately. But on the 12th of April, they played against Royal Albert at Douglas Park. Royal Albert were based, basically in Mount Clark Hall, which is only about 5 miles from here. And they were a senior club at that time. Ackies won 3-1. His last known game in Ackies colours was in another benefit match, and that was down at Stranraer on the 20th of April 1911, 5 days after the cup final replay. And the match was held for Johnny Arnott, Stranraer lad who played for both Stranraer and Accies before he went to Newcastle United. And Accies won before he played the 1500s, but even Stranraer would play after the 1500s for both of them. As you can say, he retired from the playing side of things in April before becoming a Hull director at Hamilton. And in that capacity, he often accompanied Alec Raisbeck, who was then the Accies manager. He was a former Liverpool, Partick Crystal, and they played with Scotland, obviously. He was Accies manager on that point. And the two of them used to go out scouting. And on one occasion they'd gone to Shorts, and I don't know if any of you know Shorts, but it's like, I live in a village, Colburn, a mining village in South Lancashire. And Shorts and Colburn are on the same altitude. So it snowed at the same time. We had experienced the snow on Wednesday. And probably when we went to Shorts, it was much the same. Because while on that particular scouting mission at Shorts, it took ill. And shortly after, it was reported that it was the first time, which was angry. And then, as you probably know, he was admitted to St Andrew's home in Renfrew Street in Glasgow, where tragically passed away following an operation to amputate. One day from Bible said it was very, I think from his partner was stupid. Anyway, the death was a big loss for Hamilton, in particular for football in general. He was said to have great influence in the dressing room. I think that applied in the circuit dressing room as well, the way his manner, the way he conducted himself. And it was rather surprising that he came back to Hamilton. I think it should have been more or less mentioned at the time, because he just started a lot. We called the player that before even the World Circuit. But anyway, that was the situation. There was a line of spirit merchant in the town, as you'd see in the advert, and his home address in Hamilton was Lylock, Shilling. Unable to find out where that was. So a lot of the houses didn't have street addresses as such, or numbers, they always had a name. It must have been diabolical for the person when they were trying to live in there. We'll get to more about the name of the houses. And that part of the world. On a family matter, I was able to find that two of the sons, John and William, or Johnny and Billy, as they were known, depending on which part of the world they were living in at the time, were members of Colburn Juniors, which is Holly Grant Corn, in 1928. The Colburn Juniors team won the next Lanarkshire League 3 years after that. Possible the two boys were still playing in the middle. I've got a photograph of the team here, so I can read it from this and you can still get to the end of the film. John was an inside forward with his father, the same position as that. He was away for side, he played for Colburn Juniors, I say, and later went to Hearts, where he had a short spell. And I believe he played Rivers of Trial or something. He played a game for Aldi Rovers. And then went to Dublin, where he played for the Dolphins, which I believe was starting to be a finals and fairly close in both places. The other brother, William, he went to Canada, and over there he was a Billy, it wasn't William. But I do know that while he was there, he played at central half against Celtic, Toronto. I think we've got some Toronto folk here who probably wouldn't be there, but he did play for Ulster United, that was the 22nd of June.
If anyone has any flowers that they want to lay at the grave.
Would you like to share your prayer?
Yes.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, and we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John. That's John already over from Toronto. We've got John and Declan, in fact, over from Toronto, who are representing the North American Federation of Celtic Supporters Clubs. We've also got a shout out for the James Kelly Celtic Supporters Club, who are over from Belfast with us today as well. You have a big round of applause to these two parties. Just in closing, we'd like to thank everyone for attending today's ceremony. We'd like to thank the family for giving us permission to hold the event. We'd like to thank Danny Rooney Memorials, who have done a fantastic job, as you'll see, of restoring and relettering the Celtic Cross. You'll see the before pictures in the booklet, the afters. I'd like to thank Danny Maxwell from the council and the cemetery staff here for giving us permission to hold the event on their ground. The next Celtic Graves event will be on the May the 12th to celebrate the life of Celtic legend Tommy Burns on his 10th anniversary. We hope to see you all there. Thanks very much.